Thank you, Professor Doloi. First of all, I want to thank Bengal Society of Hematology and also Professor Tufan Doloi for inviting me and giving me this opportunity. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are.
Okay. So I would like to thank Tufan and the organizer for giving me this opportunity. And I'm very pleased. It gives me immense pleasure to see the previous two presentations because it makes my job much easier, because most of the things I was planning to discuss in my case-based discussion almost covered, but still maybe it will be somewhat of rehearsal like the thing, so that it will keep an impression which will be long lasting for the other students and whoever practicing hematology, the junior fellows. So that's why I will continue and start the panel discussions. Along with me, my eminent panelists are Dr. Ankita Sen. She is a consultant hematologist and hemato-oncologist attached to Nilotan Sarkar Medical College and Hospital. She did a DM in clinical hematology from Nilotan Sarkar Medical College and Hospital. Dr. Soumo Mukherjee, who did DM in clinical hematology from Nilotan Sarkar Medical College and Hospital. He is working as a consultant hematologist in Ruby General Hospital, Kolkata, AMRI Mukundapur. He was formerly attached to Bardhaman Medical College as an assistant professor, and his subject of interest in lymphoma, myeloma, ITP. Also, there is Dr. Shajia Gulsan, who is DCH, MD, DM in clinical hematology, did from, again, from Nilotan Sarkar Medical College and Hospital. She is consultant hematologist, PLS Hospital. Along with I have my student, Dr. Joshoshi Chakraborty, who completed his DM from my institution, the Institute of Hematology and Transfusion Medicine. And his special interest is in hemophilia and other bleeding disorders. And I'm proud that I was his, guide during his thesis work and other thing. Okay, thanks, Joshoshi, for joining with us. So without spending much time, I will go to my case presentation. So I would request Kalpesh, are you there? Can you just start my slides, please?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so next slide, please. So I'll go through a case-based discussion. This is a practical case which I faced in our day-to-day workup. This is a 36-year-old female, mother of two. She was generally good health, but recently began to feel somewhat tired and noticed bruises without any trauma. But she didn't have any history of menorrhagia. And when she came to the physician, there was petechia and ecchymosis, and also there was bleeding in the mouth. On clinical examination, there was no organomegaly or lymphadenopathy, and routine CBC was determined normal except very low platelet count, less than 10,000, and there were reactive lymphocytes on the peripheral smear. Next slide, please. So my question to first panelist, Dr. Shajia, what all tests will you ask for, and how are they going to help you in the diagnosis? Next slide, please. Next slide. And what is your opinion about the role of bone marrow examination? And is there any role of antiplatelet antibody testing? And is there any role of percentage of immature platelet function and mean platelet volume? So over to Dr. Shajia. Are you there, Shajia? Hello. She was here. Yeah.
Audible?
Yeah, you are audible.
Am I audible?
Yeah, but your video is not working.
Video is not working?
Yes, now
is it okay
working.
Now?
Yeah.
Okay, sir.
So next slide, please. Okay, Shajia, continue.
So this is a 36-year-old female who has two children, presented with recent onset bleed. And we have to go through a history once again, a detailed clinical and a history and an examination. I would like to know whether she had any recent history of viral infection, history of any bone pain, any arthritis.
No, nothing.
Nothing like that.
Yeah.
So on examination, there was no lymphadenopathy, no hepatosplenomegaly.
Yeah.
That's right. So careful examination of peripheral blood smear will reveal, it does not reveal any other WBC immaturity.
No, there was any other few reactive. Yeah, few reactive lymphocytes.
Only a few reactive lymphocytes.
Yes.
Yes, that might reflect a viral, recent viral infection. Otherwise, there were no other blasts or any other cystocytes or any other abnormality on the peripheral smear.
Yeah.
Yes. So this is a case of isolated thrombocytopenia. And I also would like to know if she was on any drugs which would have caused this thrombocytopenia.
No. She was otherwise healthy. She was otherwise healthy. She didn't have any problem. She was not on any drug.
So this seems to be a case of typical primary ITP, immune thrombocytopenia.
And her routine biochemistry was normal. ANA was negative and blood-borne viral. Blood-borne viral screening was negative.
So viral serology was negative. And ANA was negative.
Okay, next slide, yes. Please. Next slide, okay. Now continue, Sajia.
Yes, sir. So I would just like to, being a case of thrombocytopenia, isolated thrombocytopenia, which is the most important, is to examine the smear and rule out pseudothrombocytopenia and other causes of thrombocytopenia. Because primary ITP is essentially a clinical diagnosis and a diagnosis of exclusion, mainly. So after the peripheral smear, I would like to do we have already done HIV and HCV. HEPA, H. pylori testing is not recommended clinically normally. And also according to the recent recommendations, a bone marrow test is not recommended until unless there are some atypical features like bone pain or prolonged fever or a weight loss or arthritis or anything causing thinking of secondary, which might point to a secondary cause of ITP or any other atypical causes of leukemia or any other thing. So, and looking at the counter, what you're saying is platelet function test and the platelet, your volume, it is usually increased. The peripheral smear, we get some large platelets, and there is not, although it points to points to a diagnosis of an increased platelet volume and a platelet distribution width, or increased immature platelet function. Otherwise, it does not, it might indicate a cause of thrombocytopenia ITP, but it is not absolutely diagnostic. In fact, in ITP, there is no one single test which can say that is absolutely this one clinches the diagnosis of ITP. And regarding another question which you had was, bone marrow examination is not recommended at present for a typical case of ITP.
May I add a few things? Actually, usually that's what you have said, right? That bone marrow usually we do not do. And I personally feel that if I can see the slide myself, then I usually do not advise. But if there is,
yes,
as already said,
so.
Yeah.
If you are sure with the smear, then we may not go for it.
I think if we can give IVIGG also, there is no need of doing bone marrow. We can see the response. And if you are planning to give steroids, and I am not sure about the bone marrow peripheral smear who has seen the quality of the pathologist, then it is better to do a bone marrow aspiration.
Exactly, sir. We want to make sure we have a look at the smear. And if we are sure by that, and then we can go ahead without doing a bone marrow itself. Okay. And regarding your antibody testing, that is also has a very low sensitivity.
Low sensitivity,
and that is also not recommended in diagnosis.
Yes. Okay. So next slide, please. So these are the recommendations that So now next question is to Dr. Ankita. Are you there?
Yeah. Yes, sir. I'm there.
Yeah. Welcome to the meeting.
Thank you, sir.
So now question to you, how are you planning to treat this patient? Although it is not recommended, but as there are a few reactive lymphocytes, and I could not see the slide personally, so I did the bone marrow. And bone marrow shows features of megakaryocytic thrombocytopenia, okay?
Okay, so now,
how are you planning to treat this patient? And when do you give injection IVIGG? And role of anti-D immunoglobulin is there, and role of platelet transfusion? These are the four questions.
Right, sir. I'll take them one by one. Good evening to the organizers, the faculty, and to all the attendees. So I'll take up the questions one by one. So we already know that this patient has been diagnosed with megakaryocytic thrombocytopenia or primary ITP in this case. So since the patient had presented with mucosal bleeding, so that per se is pointing that the platelet count is very low, likely less than 10,000. So we would have to increase the platelets as well as stop the bleeding, immediate measures. So if the cost is not a constraint, I would like to go for IVIG for this patient at the dose of 1 gram per kg for day one and possibly followed again the following day. And this would be followed by prednisolone in case of this lady at a dose of 1 milligram per kg per day. However, if possibly finances might be an issue, so we can also start with methyl prednisolone for the first 3 days at 1 gram per day, and that to be followed by prednisolone again. And like our previous speaker, Dr. Baul, has already shown the days to response and how we should monitor. Accordingly, we should follow up this patient so that we can see whether the platelets are increasing, and more importantly, whether the bleeding is being controlled, since we normally treat the patient and not the number as such. And in this context, sir has also asked whether we are giving injection IVIG. So I already mentioned that we would prefer to treat this patient with IVIG. But we can also, basically IVIG is given in case of patients where urgent control of bleeding and urgent control or increase in platelet counts is required, since the time to response is 2 to 3 days only. And apart from IVIG, for the same thing, anti-D immunoglobulin may also be used. So anti-D immunoglobulin comes with certain caveats. It cannot be given to everybody. The patient should be Rh positive. So we must find out the blood group of this patient first and also the hemoglobin 11. It should be at least 10 gram per dl, but a number of literature also mention for 8 gram per dl. But personally, I'd like to keep it on the higher side, since whenever we are using anti-D IgIg, we would have to sacrifice the RBC so that the platelet counts are sustained. And in case of severe bleeding episodes, for example, this patient has mucosal hemorrhages. She doesn't have anything else like CNS bleeds or GI bleeding. But in case of certain other emergency situations like this, or in case of this patient, possibly on the first day after judging the patient's clinical appearance, we might also have to give platelet transfusions as an emergency measure, along with the previously mentioned measures. And apart from these targeted therapies, which have been discussed, tranexamic acid, we all know, should also be given for this patient. And tranexamic acid, also we have to make sure that there is no hematuria for the patient. That would be a contraindication. So, I would just like to say that for this patient, probably we should start with IVIG and follow it up with prednisolone.
Okay, okay. So next slide, please. Next slide. So this is the plan of action, what Dr. Ankita told you. There is first line, second line, and third line. Okay, next slide, please. So in this patient, in this case, he was given IVIG followed by oral prednisolone. Patient is responded initially, but later platelet count drops again to 10,000 after 1.5 months. She was at that time was tapering dose of prednisolone to 10 milligram per day. Next slide, please. So Dr. Joshi, what is your diagnosis now? And if the bone marrow was not done initially, will you do bone marrow now? And how will you treat, and will you consider splenectomy now?
Thank you, sir. My diagnosis still remains ITP. So because we see that initially the patient has responded to IVIG, the patient was responding to steroid, the patient had a normal platelet count. Again, with the tapering of steroid, the platelet count came down. And,
I agree with you, because bone marrow also shows megakaryocytic
thrombocytopenia. Yes, sir. At the initial stage, we have also done a bone marrow. It was a bit not required, but then
not required.
We know that we are dealing with an ITP case.
No, now the question is, it is not an acute ITP. So what will you do? Sir, this after three months, 3.5 months. So
if it exceeds 3 months, then it becomes a persistent IDP.
So my now the diagnosis becomes persistent IDP. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So in persistent IDP, if the initial period there was no bone marrow done, so is it recommended to bone marrow at this stage?
The bone marrow, sir. There is no point of doing a bone marrow right now. Even if the bone marrow was not done at the initial stage, we know that the patient has responded to IV.
Yeah. Right?
So no need to do a bone marrow. No need to do a bone marrow. The patient is not an elderly patient. There is no B symptom, no splenomegaly, no lymphadenopathy. So no need to go for a bone marrow right now.
I agree with you. So Dr. how will you treat?
Regarding the treatment of persistent ITP, now since the patient is having a lower side of platelet, first of all, we have to ask the patient with the 10,000 platelet count whether the patient is having any kind of bleed or not. If the patient is having any kind of bleed, we may repeat IVIG because we need a rapid increment of the platelet count. If there is a major organ, if there is a major organ bleed, we may also consider a platelet transfusion for this patient. But if the patient is not bleeding, we can increase the dose of the steroid. We can add rituximab, and the according to the recent guideline of ASH, we can go for a TPO receptor agonist.
But TPO receptor agonist is recommended for, I mean, so far, I mean, every approval is for only chronic ITP, no?
Sir, it is approved for chronic ITP, but in some cases, some papers, it has been mentioned that it can be also used as first-line agent even. Now, even if we don't consider it as a first-line agent, as a second-line agent, we can also use TPO receptor agonist in persistent ITP as well.
I think Dr. Soikat wanted to say something, is it?
Sir, one thing I would like to mention that there is difference in guideline regarding bone marrow aspiration biopsy. Though as guideline has said that we may not do bone marrow or we should not do bone marrow, international consensus recommendation, they said if our first line agent do not work or patient relapse after first line agent, like relapse after steroid or on steroid, we can do bone marrow exam. And for another reason, that for
but in this case, because it is relapse, that's why. But because if those cases who do not respond at all to the primary line, you have given IVIGG or steroid, patient didn't respond at all, then you do bone marrow. Or if the patient relapse, so in this case, patient has relapsed. So according to that guideline, if it is not done initially, you can do. Now.
Yeah, obviously there is no good quality evidence, so can or cannot. But many Indian experts even do bone marrow examination at diagnosis. Like
I myself do if I cannot see the slide myself, I do.
And another thing I would like to mention that romiplostin by FDA approval we can use in persistent ITP or even in newly diagnosed ITP if steroid is useful.
Steroid refractory cases. Okay. And Dr. Joshi, so coming to, will you consider splenectomy at this stage?
Sir, not at this stage. Just 3 or 4 months has passed. We have a lot of drugs in our hand.
Okay.
We can wait for 1 year. It's a young patient because splenectomy will be coming with a lot of side effects.
I agree with you.
Not splenectomy right now.
I agree with you. Next slide, please. So she was actually counseled for coming to back to cases. So didn't go for rituximab because of some logistic issue. She was treated with dapsone, and prednisolone dose again increased to 0.5 milligram per kg per day. Then prednisolone tapered off after 2 weeks, and dapsone was continued. Initial platelet count normalized more than 1 lakh, but again after 2 months, when she was on 100 milligram dapsone and prednisolone was tapered to 10 milligram per day. Again, platelet count dropped to 35,000. And at that time, she had only petechias. So next slide, please. So question, Dr. Somo. So Dr. Somo, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Your video? Yeah. So now, so patient has come to almost around 1 year. Now still patient. Platelet count has come down. After 1 year, platelet count again came down to 35,000, but patient has skin bleed, but no other severe bleeding. So what will you do?
Good afternoon, everybody. The issue of ITP, the most important issue of ITP is the counseling. Before treatment, the most important part is the counseling for the patient, counseling for the patient relatives, and I think counseling to the and patient also. So the important part is not the platelet count. The important part is the bleeding manifestations, when to treat, when not to treat. Okay. So in private practice, what we see mainly that patient is not at all satisfied. If some on bleeding is there, okay, some minor bleeding is there, she was very terrorized. Actually, she needs some treatment, no? So important part, in my opinion, after 1 year, we should discuss the patient, bleeding manifestations. What, you want, when what to do you treat, want? When not to
do you want okay. some durable so, response? Do you continue some medicine which needs to be continued for long duration? Or you need some medicine which can be completed during 1 month time? So either rituximab, second is TPO agonists, and third is for the durable response is splenectomy. Three options is in our hand, and we should discuss the patient that what do you want.
Okay.
So in my opinion, in personally, I feel in this case, I should go for the TPO agonists, romiplostim or eltrombopag in this patient at this moment. Okay, and rituximab also can be given.
1 minute, please. Next slide, please. So in this case, actually, patient was not bleeding and 35,000 was the count. Only PTK was there. So what we did, SOMO, we continued the dapsone and steroid was tapered off. Yes. So she has received for a long time. After 2 months, platelet count dropped to 10,000 and now patient has developed wet purpura.
Yes.
So I think when platelet count is more than 30,000 and only occasional petechia, we might go for wait and if we, as you said, we have to counsel the patient. Yeah, that platelet count is not the important thing. So you have to counsel that you have very rightly said, you have to counsel the patient and then we follow the patient. And now patient has again came with 10,000 with wet purpura. So now next slide please. Now, Dr. Somo, can you give rituximab now? If so, what precaution will you take and what dose? What other options do you have, excluding the TPO receptor agonist? And any role of splenectomy now? And if you do splenectomy, what will you prescribe before OT? What are vaccines and role of penicillin prophylaxis? These are the questions one by one you have to.
Yes, we can give it rituximab now, but if you ask me honestly, I am in favor of TPO agonist. Okay, because I worked with rituximab in acute IT patient. My thesis paper is all rituximab also. So, okay, fine. Rituximab we can give, but before giving rituximab, we should do some basic investigations like hepatitis B screening, hepatitis B core antibody testing as guided by the FDA guideline. So, and the dose is very important because there are a lot of studies. I think there are some papers I have I shared with you also that showed that starting from 100 to 375.
Next slide, please. 1 minute. Next slides, please. Kalpesh, can you change the slide, please? Yes. Next slide.
Next one, I think. Yes. Here you can see a lot of studies about the different dosage of rituximab, starting from 100 milligram to 1 gram also. So at the standard dose is 375 milligram meter square. And here you can see there is no such difference excepting one study by Zhang et al. From 2012. Otherwise, it is almost similar results in the 100 and 375 milligram meter square. And in the next study, you can see in my paper also, I used 100 milligram fixed dose. In the next slide, can you show the next slide? So preferably 375 milligram meter square or 100 milligram, whatever you can use in weekly basis, you can give it. I think the patient can be given 375 milligram meter square also. But before giving, whatever dose you are giving, we should do a hepatitis B screening. That is very important. And what is the next question? I think forgot.
So that is the thing. Will you recommend splenectomy at this stage? And what are the other options?
Yes. Splenectomy is a very important issue. It should discuss with the patient that if you want some durable response, yes, though it is. And in fact, the recent study showed the infection rate after splenectomy and after giving rituximab and TPO or agonist almost equal. So you can go for splenectomy. But
first counseling part for the surgeon is very important before the splenectomy. When the surgeon sees the platelet count 15,000, we should counsel the surgeon that when you during the operation, when you just plot the splenic artery, platelet count automatically will come up. So that is very important. And before splenectomy, 14 days back, we previous 14 days prior to splenectomy, we have to give some vaccination. According to guidelines, we have to give vaccination with pneumococcal vaccine, meningococcal vaccines, as well as your Haemophilus influenzae type B vaccines. These vaccines should be completed before 14 days, as it is a planned splenectomy. So we can complete before the 14 days, and a following splenectomy, we have we should continue the prophylaxis. And the recent CDC guideline, we can continue with the amoxicillin 250 milligram OD for at least 3 years. At least 3 years. This is the recent guideline from the CDC. Okay.
Okay. Our patient, if the Dr. patient Shomo,
is, yes.
Dr. Shomo, one question for that. Would you recommend to platelet count of 15,000 to go to splenectomy? With that.
Pardon, please.
With platelet count of 15,000.
Kalpesh, can you change the slide? Next slide, next to next slide.
Do you recommend patient to go to splenectomy directly, or would you like to increase the platelet count by some?
Listen, splenectomy is indicated for ITP patient, refractory chronic ITP patient, you know?
Yeah, that I know, but
it's always low. The main issue is that a surgeon who is going to do the splenectomy, we should counsel the surgeon. But when he gives
I'm not asking that. I'm asking that, would you recommend any other procedure like meantime L-tromopag or omeprostin to increase?
Yeah, definitely, definitely. But as the question said, that without giving TPRA, first I tried with the rituximab, you know. Okay, yeah. And definitely rituximab is not the solution. If the patient
this patient didn't receive TPORA, so we can give TPORA before.
No, actually,
my
question was excluding TPO.
Exactly.
My question was excluding TPO actually. So that's why he is not saying TPO. My question was
because it is not recommended to go to splenectomy 15,000 count, and no surgeon will take my patient actually. That is also another problem.
Yeah.
Platelet count is.
Now listen, Shaikha, there are many patients in a
I know what you're trying to say, that when skin is cursed, when veining tied up, platelet count will rise, but it is actually not recommended. We know this, we have done this, but it's not recommended. This is also a legal issue.
No, what is the ideal platelet count according to the guideline?
We need 50,000 platelet count for any abdominal surgery.
I think for the splenectomy for ITP patient, it is not mentioned. It is not
it is actually mentioned. I don't actually remember what I read, possibly in international consensus report. I will check it, but it is written that 50,000 count would be.
But
any other surgery, you know, gallbladder surgery.
I'm not any talking about any other surgery. I'm talking about ITP and splenectomy.
No, may I interrupt if you don't mind?
Sir, yes.
Actually, Saikat, actually, you are quite new because you people, when you were studying, that time TPO RA has come into market. But when we were students, okay, that time it was not there. And we used to go for splenectomy at 5,000, 7,000, 8,000 platelet count. With that time, we used to give methyl prednisolone, or if affording, then IVIGG with platelet transfusion. Then as soon as the surgeon, at the beginning part, when there's inside the skin, there will be a little bit more bleeding. But we have given IVIGG or methyl prednisolone, and platelet transfusion is given just before the OT around 5, if SDP is there, SDP or otherwise RDP. And then as soon as the surgeon tied the splenic artery, the platelet count will jump up. I have many experience of many splenectomy. I used to go to the OT, and we used to, madam used to counsel the surgeon, you go ahead, nothing. We will take care of the bleeding. And we have seen very few complications because of the bleeding in case of ITP and splenectomy. But as you were saying, I didn't come across any guideline which is mentioning about splenectomy actually. But as you say, that is right. For any major surgery or abdominal surgery, 50,000 is the guideline. So if we consider in that way, but I have not seen, I personally have not come across any particular guideline which says the cutoff point of platelet count in splenectomy. I'm not sure. If you have, if you find out, please forward to me.
Sir, without like,
can I make a comment?
Yes,
yes, yes.
Yes, as I have been practicing hematology for a long time, we have had many occasions to carry out splenectomy with a very low platelet count. And we have never had any problems or any complications. But today, as of date, we will not dare to carry out a splenectomy with a low platelet count. Guideline or no guideline?
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Your input is very much appreciated.
Siddhartho, may I come in for once?
Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah, the point is, you see, he's not saying that you can't do it. All Shoikat is pointing out is, as of now, today's guidelines say abdominal intervention, unqualified, as far as I know, about splenectomy or not, is probably not recommended. I mean, they have not probably mentioned splenectomy.
Yes, they have mentioned about abdominal surgery or major surgery, but
unfortunately, none of us have published. Yes, not splenectomy specifically, abdominal surgery and major surgery. Yeah. And as of now, all of us have those experiences, but we have not published it. So
yeah, that is
well, we are in a bit of a soup there. Right. Thank you. That's it.
Okay, Somo, you continue. So what all vaccination you are planning to give in case of you are going for splenectomy?
Yes, yes. As I already mentioned, pneumococcal vaccines, Haemophilus influenzae type B, and meningococcal vaccine usually give and should be completed prior to 14 days before the splenectomy procedure was done. And post-splenectomy, we can continue the prophylaxis. Prophylaxis, it is a recent guideline of the CDC guideline in a splenectomy patients. We can continue with the amoxicillin 250 milligram OD. And if the patient is allergic to penicillin group of drugs, then we can go for some macrolides with roxithromycin or azithromycin 150 milligram once a day. So these are the guidelines we should follow. And in our practical life, we also follow the Pentid 400 BD we also give in the patients following the splenectomy, penicillin G. So I think these things we should follow.
Yeah. So in this patient, we had given rituximab 375 weekly, 4 doses. She didn't give consent for splenectomy because, as Dr. Somo mentioned, that we have to counsel them, and if they agree, then only we can go for splenectomy. So this patient didn't give consent. So this time we could arrange rituximab. So we have given. Also, we have given along with that high dose dexamethasone. Patient responded after 1.5 months, but again relapses after 6 months again. So next slide, please. So question to Dr. Shubham. Shubham, are you there?
Yes, sir.
So this is again, this is the case become now the chronic refractory ITP. So how will you treat? And now we can come to that portion of TPO array. The can domiplostin work in a patient who failed to respond to L-thrombopag? Can you combine both in array, TPO array? And what are the different newer agents which are in pipeline for chronic refractory ITP?
Sir, first, this is a case of chronic ITP.
Chronic refractory.
Chronic ITP, which is refractory to first line of agent.
Yes.
And also second line of agent. The rituximab is the second line.
Yeah.
So the options left are TPO agonist in the newer ages. And if we don't consider TPO agonist, then the agents will come later in the fourth question. So in the present era, the drug of choice will be definitely TPO agonist. There are three TPO agonists presently which are in use, two within India. One is romiplostin and one is L-thrombopag. And avatrombopag, I don't think it is still available in India.
Romiplostin. Yeah. Suvamka, you are not audible. Suvamka, you are not clearly audible.
Okay. Now?
Yeah,
is it audible?
It's fine now. Yeah, okay. It's fine now.
Okay. So there are three TPO agonists is available for ITP. First is romiplostin. Second is L-thrombopag. And third is avatrombopag. So in India, the romiplostim and L-thrombopag is available. In romiplostim is given weekly once in a dose of 3 microgram per kg, and L-thrombopag the starting dose is 50, and it can be given in a low dose of 25 milligram per day also. So the second question, can romiplostim work in a patient who failed to respond to L-thrombopag? There are a few studies. When the question is when we will call that
the patient didn't respond to TPO agonist, either rivaprostim or eltrombopag. If we give at least 6 weeks of therapy and there is no increment of platelet count still below 20,000, then we can call it, it is a failure to this TPO agonist, that is rivaprostim or eltrombopag. It has been seen in several studies that if there is failure to one agent, we can switch to another agent. So suppose there is failure to eltrombopag, we can switch to rivaprostim and vice versa. So rivaprostim can work in a patient who failed to respond to eltrombopag. And there are a few studies where given both TPO agonist along with prednisolone in lower dose. So we can also combine both TPO agonist, but if we combine both TPO agonist, the problem or the side effects anticipated is thrombosis or thromboembolic agents. So we should take proper history that patient is not prone to the thrombosis or thromboembolic agents, thromboembolic manifestations. If we become sure there is no risk factor for these thrombosis, then we can combine both TPO agonist. Now, newer agents in pipeline for chronic refractory ITP, there are namely a few agents. The newer agents are TPO agonist. Other agents, we all know, dapsone, cyclosporine, we can combine various agents and we can give steroids in several in low dose, etc.
Those are actually old agents, but newer means fostamatinib and rozanolixizumab. Those are the two newer agents which have not come yet actually. I think abatrombopag, it has come abroad but not to India. So those are the few agents which are in pipeline. Abatrombopag, fostamatinib, rozanolixizumab, which is a Fc receptor recycling agent. These are the,
okay.
And Dr. Saikat, are you there?
Okay. Yes, sir. Hello, I'm there.
So,
I'm here, sir.
So these are the things I can remember. Can you remember any other newer agent?
No, sir. I only like to mention that fostamatinib is now approved. We can use, which is TPORA refractory, we can use in fostamatinib, though not available in our country.
About rombopag and rozanolixizumab, which is a Fc receptor.
This is a recycling agent.
Yeah. And something has come from China that is recombinant human thrombopoietin receptor agonist actually. So that is recently developed in China. It is not yet FDA approved also. Okay. So I think that concludes our discussion. Now I would like to hand over the mic to the organizer. Before that, any of the panelists or any of the senior consultant who are present?
Can I make one small comment?
Yes, ma'am.
This is a 36 years old lady with quite a refractory ITP. I would definitely do lupus antibodies and screen for lupus, because if she's positive, then an immunosuppressive drug will be very useful for her, like azathioprine or something like that.
Yes, I agree. MNF. With you. Yeah, ma'am. Yeah, right. That should have been done in the workup. We have not done. Yeah, that should have been done. So, any more comments from any of the viewer, any of the senior consultant, or any of the panelists?
Sir, I just want to mention two things. One thing is in reference to use of eltrombopag and rivaprostim as alternate agent, whether one can be used after other. Now, Shubham has correctly pointed out they can be used. Just want to add that we know that the mechanism and the site of action of both drugs are different. As Shoikatta showed in his picture, if you look at the CMPL, that is the TPO receptor, the rivaprostim acts at the extramembranous site, whereas the eltrombopag acts at the transmembranous part. So both drugs can be used one after other. Another thing I want to point out, sir, in your very first slide, you asked whether the type of antibody is necessary to detect before starting the therapy of ITP. No, it is not recommended like that. But there are certain studies which say that if the antibody is against GP2B3A, it has got a better prognosis than GP1B9 antibody.
But there are only two studies I could find, when both are from the China actually. Yes. I didn't find a very large RCT.
No, sir. The population was not very large, and they have told that the media, the platelet destruction in which GP2B3A is involved, that involves a Fc receptor mediated anti platelet destruction. So that has got a better prognosis since it responds to drugs better than GP1B9, which is a Fc receptor independent platelet destruction. That's the thing I wanted to point out.
Thank you. Thank you. Anything anyone want to add?
Yes, sir. So I would just like to add something that regarding platelet transfusions in the emergency condition of active bleeding in case of ITP. So a lot of studies have been conducted. None has shown that giving platelets actually increases antiplatelet antibodies. So we should treat it as an emergency situation as such. And if required, then we should go ahead with platelet transfusion. And that's all.
Thank you, Dr. Siddhartha Shankar Rai, for the wonderful panel discussion and also the esteemed panelists. All a request, please stay. There is a couple of questions is there, so we'll discuss one by one. And anybody can give his or her the expert opinion. So moving to the question one by one. So the first question is the 12-year-old boy with immune thrombocytopenia. So how do you choose the first line of the therapy? This goes to Dr. Subramanian, but yes, other can also free to give the answer. Dr. Subramanian, please.
Yeah, good evening, sir. 12-year boy with immune thrombocytopenia. If it is newly diagnosed, I have already mentioned as per the guidelines, whether it is, we have to examine the patient, whether it is grade 1, grade 2, grade 3, grade 4, what type of bleeding it is. If it is in grade 1, grade 2, look for the platelet count. If the platelet count is more than 20,000, there is only skin bleeds, you can observe. Only if the platelet count is less than 20,000 and there is a mucosal bleed, and if the patient is far away from a hospital setting, hospitalize the patient, start oral steroids. And if the child is coming with a life-threatening bleed at presentation, go for agents like IVIG or anti-D or methylprednisolone IV to increase the platelet count rapidly.
Right. So in terms of the curative potential, in terms of the curative potential of the first line of the drug, you have the steroid. The steroid means somnacotyl is there, means the prednisolone. There is a dexamethasone is there. And also you have IVIG also there, and also the anti-D is there. So in terms of the long-term remission rate, so which drugs you choose in your clinic?
Okay, sir.
Terms of the long-term response rate.
Because none of the yes,
because the IVIG and anti-D you give maximum
4 to 6 weeks they have a response rate, and then after that we need to add something. With steroids, with tapering, at least 60% of the patients, they remain. Mostly I have shown a slide where the child and the presentation with a triggering viral infection with no severe bleeds, they go into a long-term remission. Adults don't go into remission, but if they cross 3 months, if they go into persistent stage or chronic stage, we have to add agents as per the choices. We need to maintain a safe platelet count above 30,000.
Yes. Anybody have any comment on this issue?
Start your video.
Dr. Somunil, please on your video.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Dr. Somo, anything you want to add in terms of the long-term response rate?
ITP is it is very difficult to predict for the long-term response for ITP at least. Who will go?
What the evidence says?
Hello?
Evidence
for the pediatric ITP, for the pediatric patients ITP, definitely if we can continue the dexamethasone, high dose dexamethasone for 4 days, and we can repeat it after 14 days for 2, it shows maximum benefit.
Right. So Dr. Somo has rightly pointed out the important issue, because if you use the dexamethasone in the frontline setting of the children ITP, there's a different dosage schedule is available. You can give the continuously 4 days, then it can off, or you can repeat it. But if you follow up the patient in the long term, yes, the remission rate of the dexamethasone is higher comparing to the other prednisolone and IVIG and anti-D.
But
okay, I want to add something. The present guidelines, both the ASH 2019 guidelines and the International Working Group consensus, that regarding all the three steroids, the regarding prednisolone and dexamethasone, what I found interesting, I should share with the audience. Both are of same potency. Both are of equivalent potency. Okay. The good thing about dexamethasone or prednisolone is that about dexamethasone is that you give for only 4 dex, the adherence of therapy is better compared to prednisolone. And as far as the response assessment at the end of 1 year, it's only 60 to 66% for both the agents. They have not given any preferences. I was also having the same impression. What
the evidence is that all the steroid is similar. But yes, there is a head-to-head comparison trial is there. At least the two trials have been published. There is a slight better long-term response rate with the dexamethasone. Next, anybody want to say something or we can move to the second question?
I just wanted to make one statement. Yes, I consider IVIG as a stopgap measure for treatment of acute hemorrhage in ITP.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, that is not ruled out. For anything, a life-threatening bleed, ma'am. Suppose somebody comes with IC bleed. Suppose somebody comes with a GI bleed. Or suppose somebody is more than 50 years with comorbidities, go for IVIG. And present era with COVID infections, go for IVIG, ma'am. That is physician discretion. That is not wrong.
Dr. Sugmal, another question for you. You have another question. In terms of the IVIG and NTD, if you look the cost issue, so the NTD is quite cheaper comparing to the intravenous immunoglobulin.
What will be your advice?
Listen, in terms of the cost, in terms of the response rate.
Sir, IVIG and NTD, but the thing is that I prefer IVIG, though the cost is high, but IVIG is also unique side effects, headache, aseptic meningitis, which has to check the creatinine. But the NTD, though the cost is low, but the US people are not in favor of so much of NTD. They have said that there are black box warnings, you should counsel the patient. Yes, it's okay, fine. We can use in emergency setting in India, it's available, it's cost effective, no issues.
Anybody want to comment on this issue? Dr. Santunuda, anything? Dr. Santunuda, please.
No, I mean, that's okay. I mean, steroids, in this particular case, I think steroids should do the job well. Whether you choose prednisolone or...
Santunuda, IVIG, NTD.
Oh, I'm sorry. I missed IVIG and NTD. Yes, I personally would prefer IVIG. In children, you know, it's safer than NTD. And I rarely use NTD with so many black box warnings. In children, it is less costly than adults for IVIG.
Yes, yes.
So it is a possibility that you can in practical life.
The only issue of the NTD is the low hemoglobin. You cannot use it. And there is a Rh negative patient. There is a less response rate. Post-plenectomy patient, there is a less response rate. Otherwise, there is no major problem in terms of the NTD, but yes, the availability is the issue for giving the NTD. Next, moving to the next important issue, that the 65-year male with isolated thrombocytopenia. So, do you advise the bone marrow examination?
Absolutely, sir. I will go for a bone marrow examination.
So, you do bone marrow aspiration and the bone marrow biopsy together, or you should do the bone marrow aspiration only?
No, both, sir. I will do both.
So, what are the indication you should... order for the bone marrow?
Sir, in a, the guidelines clearly mentions anyone above 60 years presenting with isolated thrombocytopenia, go for a bone marrow study, sir. They have...
I have some things. I think if it is a frank case of isolated thrombocytopenia without any organomegaly, lymphadenopathy, fever, whatever it may be...
Sir, age matters.
Age matters.
Clearly. Yes, 60 years.
Suman, please hold on. Continue.
Yes. If the patient having isolated thrombocytopenia without, you know, organomegaly, lymphadenopathy or any abnormal cells, whatever, no history of fever, is the age really matters?
Yes.
About 60. It is the evidence. Is it evidence-based?
No,
and what is
the guidelines, Shomo, is mentioning that above 60, you should go for a marrow examination with an isolated thrombocytopenia.
Okay. I would like to mention only one thing. 5% of MDS patient can present with only
thrombocytopenia.
And as a hematologist, I don't want to miss a case of MDS.
Right. So yeah, the man, thing is that Dr. Subbarnil is rightly pointed out in terms of this isolated thrombocytopenia, even though there is a peripheral smear is normal, the WBC is normal, hemoglobin also normal, there is no clinical abnormality, you should go ahead with the bone marrow examination to try to find out not only the ITP, but the MDA, sometimes the aplastic anemia is also evolving. So these things should rule out.
Actually, I would like to do aspiration biopsy and cytogenetics also. I will collect the sample because I, in my mind also, above 60, there is a possibility of MDS and a bone marrow is a procedure. I cannot repeat it now and again. So I will collect the cytogenetic sample also. I will do bone marrow aspiration and biopsy, collect the cytogenetic samples and bone marrow aspiration report. If so, within one day it will come, cytogenetics report, I can keep in the heparin for the next day also. Okay. Right. And so I would like to keep the cytogenetics also.
Right. So bone marrow aspiration, bone marrow biopsy, along with the cytogenetics, you have to send in the single setting to try to rule out the other cause of the isolated thrombocytopenia. Very right. So the another important question is that, is there any role of the TPU in the first line of the setting? Because sometimes we can give the several examples that the 30 years male patient have been given the first line of treatment with IVIG. After 3 to 4 days, the platelet count is again 10,000 with the active bleed. So sometimes we add the steroid, the patient is not responding. Sometimes we can add the anti-D also, but the patient is not responding. So okay, in these challenging cases, how do you treat this patient or any role of the TPU in the first line of the setting? Do it recommended.
Can I ask you?
Yes. Ami boli somo shesh kore di.
Yes.
And the thing is that, sir, the TPORA, the guidelines, both the ASH guidelines and the IMWC does not endorse as the frontline agent. But as you mentioned, they can be used when they are not responsive to IVIG, not responsive to IV methylprednisolone, or not responsive to INTD. Then TPO can be agent. We cannot pick from Romi or Eltropran. Either of the agents can be used. And still, there is no head-on randomized controlled trial between the agents or comparing both the agents, whether they can be used in the frontline cell. But a physician who feels an emergency it can be used, it can be tried.
Right.
But as of now, in the guidelines.
Dr. Somo, please.
I don't know about the studies, but personally, in severe diabetic patient, I have used two patients. In high diabetic patients, in which patient steroid is really a very difficult thing to give. So I have used patients in first line setting. Patient was not able to purchase the IVIG. So I have used in two patients romiplostim in first line settings. And it worked like a brilliant.
I will personally advise you, Dr. Shom.
Yes, Dr. Subbarnil.
Dr.
Subbarnil's voice is not audible. His voice is breaking. Surmila ma'am, any comment from this issue? In terms of the TPO, please unmute. Surmila ma'am, please unmute. So, any comment on this issue?
Well, I was not listening very carefully.
Achha, so the question is that sometimes it is very difficult patient where the first line of the drug, the none is effective for treating the newly diagnosed patient of the ITP. So the patient is bleeding, the platelet count in 10,000 after using the steroid, IVIG and anti-D. So there is any role of the TPO agonist in this patient, though it is not recommended by the any guidelines. What is your opinion in terms of your practice?
Well, if it is a primary refractory ITP, then I will definitely use TPO agonist.
Right. So, Dr. Santanu, any comment on this?
I have just one comment, you know. When you have a difficult case, then sometimes, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Sorry. When you have a difficult case, sometimes as Dr. Baul has said that you can go beyond the guidelines. And in this case, probably TPORA is...
Right.
I mean, you can definitely give it a try because these are not ordinary cases, you know. When you have primary refractory ITP, then these are not cases which is going to respond very well.
Absolutely. So sometime we can use the TPO agonist, either the eltromup and the romiplostim in case of the very bad patient who is not responding to the first line of the drug. So the next question is that any role of the combination treatment of the refractory ITP, Dr. Soikot?
Yeah, obviously, treatment. I have shown a lot of combination therapy before TPA-RA, ADA, we used Dapsone plus steroid, we used Aja plus Danazole, even Cyclosporine, MMF, Azathioprine, any type of combination and all type of combination are used.
And in the era of the TPO agonist, any trial of this,
yes, with eltromobag and romiplostin, immunosuppressive agent is combined. And also,
Also,
other agent like TPO-RA plus fostamatinib plus IVIG, there are different trials because there is no good quality of evidence, but these are tried. Combination of TPO-RA with immunosuppressive agent and with FC blocking agent.
Right. So, Dr. Ankita, any question, any comment on this issue?
Tufan sir, can I say something?
Yes, yes. After the Ankita, Dr. Ankita, please.
Okay, sir. So regarding this, I just wanted to say that it is there in different trials. Like Dr. Bowles has already pointed out rightly that it's not in the first line recommendation, but still in different trials, it has been seen that romiplostim can be used. Though it's a second line agent, it can be used in case of newly diagnosed ITP. Like you rightly said that once the steroids, IVIG, anti-D seem to be not working. So that's
now, all. We are discussing the combination treatment of the ITP, refractory ITP. Means in the era of the TPO agonist, there is a deltropopag is there, romiplostim is there, then there is other immunosuppressant is there. This, so there is several trial is there for the combination of the drug. If you combine with eltromopag with androgen, you can combine the eltromopag along with the cyclosporine. You can combine eltromopag with the mycophenolate. So the response rate is quite high.
Yes.
Dr. Somo, please.
Can I share one experience with you?
Yes, yes.
In one patient whom finance was the matter, so I reduced the dose of eltromopag. Okay. And it was 25 milligram twice a week. But with that dose, patient was failed to maintain the platelet count. So I used steroid plus eltromopag. Oh, no. Steroid, very minimum dose, 10 milligram plus eltromopag, and it creates a magic. Platelet is 80,000, 85,000. So definitely, there is a role of combination therapy with eltromopag, with romiplostim, with steroid.
Yeah, there is also good studies with romiplostim with 2.5 or 5 milligram of steroid.
Exactly.
And they produce good
results. Potentiates the activity of romiplostim. That's
Right, right. Dr. Sarkot is absolutely right. There is a romiplostim data on this aspect is there. So move on to the another question. So in terms of this eltromopag vis-a-vis the romiplostim, so you have a two drug in your hand for managing the refractory ITP. So, in your practice, which drug you choose and why?
So, there is no head-to-head trial. So, we don't have any scientific data. And as the impetuscent patient, and we should discuss with patient if what the patient wants, a regular injection or oral drug, and if any liver dysfunction, dietary restriction, patient preference, and cost is matter. Eltromobag cost around 50,000 per month and romiplostim around 10,000-12,000 per month. So these are the issues we should discuss with patient and decide.
Right. So the important thing is that in terms of the, if you consider the cost issue, the romiplostim is slightly cheaper than the eltromobag. And if you consider the patient convenience, the romiplostim has to be given subcutaneous, eltromopag has to be taken oral. The third important thing is that in terms of this, the romiplostim and the eltromopag, though the effectivity is similar in both the cases, sometimes the patient prefers to take the oral medicine. And the fourth important issue is that in terms of the adverse effect, both the drug causes liver dysfunction. Eltromopag also causes liver dysfunction, the romiplostim also can cause the liver dysfunction. So as Dr. Soikoti rightly pointed out, we have to discuss the issue to the patient and the patient relative. We can choose any one of the drugs. But in terms of the efficacy, if we consider the efficacy, though the trial is saying that more or less similar, so there is a little bit difference in terms of efficacy of the loramiplasty vis-a-vis eltromopag in Indian setting. So I want to know the experience from this esteemed panelist in terms of the loramiplasty. In your practice, so you, in terms of the efficacy in Indian patient. Dr. Somu, please.
Yeah, though the data is very low in my patient, I am talking about my patients. I have five or six patients of eltromopag and romiplostim and 10 patients of eltromopag. Definitely, the romiplostim efficacy, I think little bit better in my patients. Okay. And in few patients, I switched from eltromopag to romiplostim also. But one issue when we are doing the trial in NRS, as you have noticed in the romiplostim, after the stoppage of the romiplostim, there is a rebound thrombocytopenia. I think, I don't know what will happen to this patient, but we should be careful about the rebound thrombocytopenia after the stoppage of the romiplostim, which we have faced during the trial in NRS.
At that time, actually, we did not have any discontinuation protocol. No,
the trial ended, we have to stop it abruptly.
Yeah.
That's why there is a problem.
Nowadays, it is not recommended.
But practice is the difference. Dr. Somila, ma'am, any comment on this issue? In terms of efficacy of the romiplostim vis-a-vis the eltromopag in your practice?
Well, I have had no issues with romiplostim. I found it just as good. And in the small number of cases where I've used, it has been successful. We have titrated the dose. It is easy to titrate and it is given once a week. Only thing is it's a subcutaneous injection. That is a bit of a problem. But I'll mention one of my cases as a sort of a thought-provoking thing. This was an elderly lady who had come from North Bengal and she had a refractory ITP. So we gave her eltrombopag and sent her home. And she responded well and was lost for follow-up for 2 years. After 2.5 years, she came back with a severe thrombocytopenia. And this time we discovered that her counts were getting low. So we did a bone marrow and full workup. And we found that she has got a liver disease now. Now, whether this liver disease is because of eltrombopag or she had it earlier, we had not been able to diagnose it, I do not know. But we give a routine workup like an ultrasound and all that. There was no problem with that. But this is just a caveat to say that when we use these things, we must follow up our patients properly.
Right. Dr. Santur Masu, any comment on this issue in terms of efficacy of romiplostim vis-a-vis eltromopag in your practice? Dr. Santur Masu, please. Possibly he is unable to hear us.
He's there.
Are you talking about me?
Yes.
Right. Right. You see, sorry. One of the calls came in. So
in terms of efficacy of the romiplostim and eltrombopag in your practice, any difference of the efficacy?
I gave steroids with romiplostin. The man had a count of around 50,000-60,000. He had a CNS bleed initially, and after adding a bit of steroids, I had to, because he had to go for a vitrectomy, and so I thought that a little bit of higher counts were necessary for vitrectomy. And with adding a little bit of steroids, the counts went through the roof. I mean, this is something very unusual. I've never seen from 60,000 to 1,60,000. I mean, this is something good. I never seen this with eltrombopag, but I did see this with romiplostim.
Right.
Adding a little bit of steroids.
Dr. Siddhartha Shankar is there?
Yes.
So what is your, in terms of the romiplostim vis-a-vis the eltrombopag efficacy in your practice?
Actually, I have not used much romiplostim in my practice. I have used few eltrombopag. Eltrombopag was good in all my patients, but thing is that what Dr. Somo told, no, that after stopping, there is usually
abrupt decrease in the platelet count. Nowadays, as Dr. Saikat rightly said, that previously we used to stop abruptly. That's why now there is a recommendation how you can stop. So we have to follow that recommendation and then we can stop. Then you have to find out. In my practice, I didn't have much experience about romiplostim.
Now, the thing is that the Saikat is telling the different issue and the Somu is telling in the same issue. The trial is designed like that, but it is never recommended that you stop the drug abruptly. You have to continue the drug and try to diminish the platelet count. The trial have been designed in such a way that you have to give in the drug for the 2 to 3 months and then stop. This is the trial. This is the not a clinical practice. In the clinical practice, you have to continue the drug and you have to follow the platelet count. And then you have to follow the guideline for the discontinuation of the drug and all these things in there. So as the Somu is rightly pointed out and the Sormilamab also rightly pointed out, in terms of the efficacy, if you look at the Romiplostim and the Eltromopac, in particularly the Indian patients, I think the Romiplostim is slightly superior than the Eltromopac. We have plenty of the examples there. After giving the Eltromopac, even in the full dosage of the 75 mg, the patient is not responding. But yes, after giving the Romiplostim of the 5 micrograms subcutaneous weekly doses, and the platelet count is started rising. So there is some advantage of the Romiplostim, I think, is there in Indian patient, but the explanation is still not there. And also, head-to-head comparison is not there. But yes, in our clinical practice, in terms of the efficacy, Romiplostim is slightly better than the Eltromopac in terms of the efficacy for rising the platelet count.
So one thing I would like to mention for our audience that though in Romiplostim, while it's written in 250 microgram, actually 375 microgram of drug is there. So sometimes we use full vial and so the dose, sometimes it's overdose. Actually, when I started using, I didn't know the fact that the vial contains 375 milligram. It's not...
No. That is different issue. That is different. The two vials are there. 250, 500. No.
I am talking
about... I am talking about
250 milligram vial. Yes. It's 250 milligram vial per... 0.5 ml. Actually, the diluent is 0.72 ml.
It will be 0.5 ml. When we add
We have to give 0.72 ml and give patient 0.5 ml. We have to discard the rest.
When we add 0.72 ml to the powder, it will be 0.5 ml. 0.5 ml contains 250 microgram of the drug.
Dr. Saikat, the thing is that Dr. Somu has rightly pointed out, though we are adding the 0.72 ml, but if you exactly draw the amount of in your syringe, it will around the 0.5 to sometimes the it is slightly higher than that. But you're absolutely right. So we are not giving the 0.72 ml of the drug. So we are giving the 250 mg drug, but yes, depending upon the weight, you have to adjust the dose. So there's a couple of another question is there. I'll go quickly to the questions. So the question from Dr. Prakash Kumar Mondal, as we are the very important question he raised, that in terms of the ITP, the what platelet count you allow your patient to go to the splenectomy safely, though we have been discussing a little bit in this issue of the platelet count. So he's raised the important issue for safe platelet count. We already addressed this issue. Though there is a guideline is that in terms of the abdominal surgery, the 30,000, 50,000 is there, but in ITP, it is very difficult to maintain that platelet count. Sometimes we can go ahead with the surgery with the low platelet count also. Dr. Siddhartha Sankara has been beautifully explained these things. So we can go ahead with the low platelet count, but yes, nowadays there is a counseling is very, very important. The consenting is very, very important. And also the risk of the bleeding during surgery has to be conveyed to the patient and the patient relative. And nowadays, there is a combination of the drug is there. You can use it before the splenectomy to raise the platelet count a little bit. But yes, if it is emergency, you can go ahead with the low platelet count with the surgery. So we have been already discussed this issue. The another question from the Tezoni, that what is the type of the response of the ITP? So how early the response is there? Anybody can address this issue in terms of the newly diagnosed ITP, I think. Dr. Subranil, you can give this answer.
Well, sir,
after giving the first line of the drug, so in terms of the early response.
The responses start, we should check the platelet count after 40 to 72 hours.
The IVIG response is within 4 days. The NTD also 2 to 7 days. And methylpred also, the response is also within 40 to 72 hours.
Right. So another question from Dr. Ananto, that the important question he has been raised, that what would be the minimum platelet count to conceive and what is the minimum platelet count for a cesarean section?
Pregnancy, sir, the current guidelines says platelet count more than in a patient with ITP lady can conceive with anything around more than 30,000. No need to make it 1 lakh. But if the lady is nearing delivery, then a platelet count for uraxial is around 50 to 80,000. No necessity to make it 1 lakh. But 50 to 80,000 would be safe around delivery. And then there are some protocols to manage the the newborn after delivery, and it's a separate topic.
Right.
But Doctor, throughout it is more than 30,000.
Right. Dr. Amarnath is asking that can you use the NTD in RH negative patient? Anybody can ask Dr. Somo or
NTD is not indicated in RH negative patients because what is the mechanism of action of NTD? That is very important. NTD acts in the D positive, that is the RH positive RBC. It will kill the RBC, the macrophage will engulf the RBC, and it will leave the platelet to increase. That is the basic mechanism of NTD in ITP in a nutshell. So it should be used in RH positive patient only.
Preferably, right. Another question from Dr. Nivedita Moulik, that we have been discussing some issue of the BBV, that is called the bloodborne virus. So he is asking, what do you exactly mean the bloodborne virus? Dr. Ankita?
By the bloodborne viruses, we mean HIV, HCV in context to ITP. In context to ITP, we should measure, we should check for these viruses before proceeding.
Right. So I think we have been addressing all the questions raised by our the audience, and we have a fruitful discussion.